Welcome to the 3C Live Experience, a dynamic, multiracial, fast-growing church with thousands of believers filled with passion for God and for people. Let's join 3C in this live experience.
Amen. Are you ready for the word? Now, today I want to speak about the vision as far as 3C is concerned and our different venues that are connected to us. It affects you as well. And the places where we are at Polokwane, where you are at, we've got a building there. We've got premises there. We are in Alberton. We've got premises, Nigel. We've got premises, Josie. We've got a building there as well. And then the other places are rented facilities that we have. But in our main buildings that we operate out of, what I'm dealing with today, the vision has got to do with that as well. And therefore, I want to speak about sowing. I want to speak about giving. I want to speak about generosity. I want to speak about sowing seed. And even in the time that we find ourselves, I know that this word is going to bless you and this word is going to help you. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 19. It says there, do not lay for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. Say with me, do not. Yes. He says, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So our heart must be in eternity. Our heart must be for people's lives to be touched and changed and transformed. So the question then is, where is your treasure? Your treasure is seen where you sow your finances, where you sow your time. So your money that is precious to you, or your time that is also precious to you. Once again, where your treasure is, there your heart will be. Are you hearing me? So you can say one thing, but your actions show something different. So it's not what you say, it's where you give that determines where your heart is. You understand? You can say, I'm not selfish, but if you only use your money for yourself, you are selfish. While I don't have, you still selfish. So you can't say something. You can't feel generous and say, well, I'm generous because I feel generous. No, you're only generous when you take what you have and you give it away. Can I get a big amen there? That's why the Bible says when you take your bread, you share your bread with the poor. It's not you give out of your excess, you give of what you have. So when you got a sandwich, you usually eat a full sandwich. Then when you share your bread, it means you take half your sandwich. Now you go on a diet, hallelujah, can I get an amen there? And you give your food to somebody else. So there is more spoken about money in the Bible than any other subject. That's why when you say money, people go immediately, they go like, it's like this, yes. Because it's your master. It's your slave. That's why when you get into church and they talk about money, you get all worked up. You're like this. Oh, because it's your master. It's your slave. You're the slave. Now, as you can see, we've taken up offering before I'm speaking. Okay, because I'm here to help you in lifestyle. I don't want your money. I don't need your money. I am the biggest donor in this church at the moment. I am the largest contributor to this ministry. Are you hearing me? So I'm not one of these prophets that milk their church for their own gain. We are here. Everything we put back into the community. But I need to help you because I want you to be free. Are you hearing me? So what you do with your money is who you are. If you're spending it on drugs, you're a drug addict. If you're spending it on alcohol, you're an alcoholic. If you're spending it just on food, you're a glutton. So don't look down on them drug addicts now. Okay, so let's not get all judgy here today. Okay, judge yourself, not your spouse. Okay, so we're here today to look at our hearts because I want you to be blessed in your finances like you are blessed, like I am blessed, and our family is blessed, and we've learned the principles of God over the last 30 plus years. I want you to also partake in that. Are you hearing me here today? But here's the thing, you've got to be a giver. You've got to be generous. So it starts off with the heart. Say with me, it's everything has to do with the heart. Okay. So he says, where is your treasure? That's your heart. Is your treasure in winning souls? Is your treasure in the transformation of the culture of a nation? Where your treasure is. So let's look at the next verse. Verse 22 says, the lamp of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, God help you. He says, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you, listen to this. If the light that is in you is dark, how great is the darkness? How dark are you? Now, when we talk about the eye, it's talking about vision. Say with me, vision. Okay, so note these verses are after one another. We're talking about money. This is what it's showing. So it first of all starts with heart. It says your heart is shown by where you put your money. If your money is for your survival, you're selfish. Okay? It's about you. Everything is about you, and you will stay in that cycle of poverty. Listen to this. I don't have to prophesy. This is a fact of life. Like this carpet is black. This is a fact of life. You will stay poor and we will bury you poor. Even if you win the lotto and you get the 10 million or 20 million, 2-3 years, that's gone. Because it's a mentality. Doesn't matter what you get or what money people give you or what grant the government gives you, you will never ever have money because of your mind and because of your heart. Are you hearing me yet today? We're going to do an altar call today for your money. This, the heart. Are you hearing me yet today? So, the question is now your vision. How do you see? In other words, your vision determines how you make decisions. So the point of departure of the eye and what you see determines how you make decisions. And if you're in a poverty mentality and you're dark, all your decisions will be maintenance-based. That's why you can have people with resources that are actually still poor, still slaves. I'll talk about that just now. So, the question is, where is your treasure? Where is your vision? Where is your vision? Then he goes on in verse 24. He says, no one can serve two masters. The question today then is, who is your master? For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other, because you cannot serve God and mammon. Mammon is money god. You cannot, note, he doesn't say you can't serve God or the devil. So that's why there's more I know many of your prosperity teachers, they're teaching, Jesus, there's so many verses in the Bible, Jesus preached about money. He warns more about, Jesus has never preached prosperity. Most of what Jesus has to say about money has got to do with warning. There's more people going to hell because of money than any other thing. You'll kill somebody for R100. You will gossip and kill someone's reputation. Maybe you haven't stabbed a physical knife, but you've stabbed a mental knife, where you put out an email or you've dropped a little word negative about someone so that they can have a different thought because you're eyeing the promotion or you want or whatever. It's the same stab. God says, I look at you and a murderer, you're still the same. You're a murderer. There's no difference. It's the same spirit. Are you hearing me here today? So when it comes to mammon, you can't serve God and mammon. You have to choose. Now, if you choose God, because in verse 33, what does it say? Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All these things will be added unto you. So therefore, where is your treasure? Where is your vision? Who is your master? Where is your passion? In other words, where is your seeking? If you're seeking the physical, that is not God's blessing. God's blessing is seeking the spiritual. And then he says, then the other things will be added unto you. And that's why he says in verse 25, he says, therefore I say to you, do not worry. Shout it out. Say to me, do not worry. Interest rates go up, say with me, do not worry. Petrol price goes up, say with me, do not worry. Rumors about the company, say with me, do not worry. Rumors, say with me, do not worry. Rumors, say with me, do not worry. Client phones you feel a little bit edgy, say with me, do not worry. God's in control. Now you're sitting with this stress. You're carrying the stress of what people think or what people say. Why? Because it's a client or it's a customer or it touches your money or whatever. Here's the thing. He says, you do not have to worry about your life, what you will eat or drink or what clothes you shall wear. He says, for after these things, verse 31, he says, do not worry or say what we shall eat, what shall we drink, what shall we wear, for after these things the Gentiles seek, the unbelievers seek. He says, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. Say with me, thank you, Lord, that you know what I need before I know what I need. And maybe many of the things that you want is because you don't really need it. And it will keep you from vision. So you've got dreams about stuff. God's not giving you the stuff because you're still dark. Because when you get it, well, when I get it, then I, Lord, I laughed. One person said, oh, you know, Lord, I win the lotto. A guy came to me very excited. Oh, Pastor Bert, if I win the lotto, I'm thinking, you're playing the lotto? He wasn't even shy. You understand? And he was really excited. He believed himself. I'm going to give 10% to the... Seriously? Think about this. If God helps you to win the lotto, you're going to give him 10%. I mean, if I was God, I would say that's bad business. Are you hearing me? Look, if I'm the main investor, I mean, are you hearing me? I mean, you know, if you're giving the arm and say, look, I'd say, look, I give you 10%, I keep 90. Are you hearing me? I mean, how stupid are people? Are you hearing? No, 10% is what you give to God. That's, we're not even talking about that. 10% belongs to the Lord. That's baby stuff that. It is God's. I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking, this morning, I'm not talking tithes. We all saved. We know tithes go to the Lord. When you took out your budget, 10% is God's. You don't touch that. I'm not talking about tithes this morning. I'm talking about the 90% that's got left. How to invest in godliness, in righteousness, not where moths and rust destroy. Can I get a big amen there? Amen. Now, when you do that, you do not have to worry. Amen? Oh, time's running out. Quickly look at with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. And I want to help you with seed this morning. So 2 Corinthians 9 verse 5. Therefore, I thought it necessary to exhort you, brethren, to go to you ahead of time and to prepare. Say to me, prepare. Amen. Prepare your generous gift beforehand. Generosity must be planned. That's why I'm not big on emotional giving. This working up the crowd and stuff and then taking up offering and you know what, and you feel compelled and now it's faith and you know. And I've sat in meetings like that. That's not, you know, people say it's the Holy Spirit. I'm not too sure. To me, it sounds like manipulation. Are you hearing me here today? I don't want anybody to manipulate because there's no blessing for you if you manipulate it into your giving. So it's got to be a lifestyle. I don't want you to give today. I want you to have a generous lifestyle. You understand? And not just towards the church, towards everybody around you. It must be who you are. Can I get a big amen there? Amen. So say with me, planning. Amen. So plan your giving, right? Prepare your generous gift beforehand that you have previously promised that it may be ready as a matter of generosity and not a grudging obligation. So number two, it's got to do with the attitude that you give. There's got to be an attitude of faith. So as a matter of generosity. Then verse 6, he says, but I say to you, now here is investment terms. He says, he who sows sparingly will reap sparingly. He who sows bountifully will reap bountifully. It's not rocket science. You take any farmer knows if you don't plant a seed, you don't reap a harvest. Any farmer knows you don't plant one seed and then expect the whole field. Are you hearing me here today? But if he plants one seed, he knows he's going to get a multiplication of many seeds from one plant, but he's only going to get one plant from one seed. So, say with me, sparingly, reap sparingly. Say with me, bountifully, reaps bountifully. Are you hearing me here today? So, you look in verse 7. So, let each one give as he purposes. Say with me, purpose. As you purpose where? In your heart. Now that brings me back. Where is your treasure? Okay, now it goes back to, okay, where is your heart? See, because your heart then determines your vision. What is your vision? When you're giving, it's not a blind giving to a church or to an institution. You've got to know what gets done with the money. Are you hearing me here today? What's the purpose of the church? What are we doing? It's not a blind giving and a blind whatever, and I give to the man of God. You are responsible for what you do with your monies. Can I get a big amen there? Don't be stupid givers. Pay $8,000 for a prophecy. That's not in the Bible. Are you hearing me? Charging to pray for people and charging to get a prophecy from the prophet, from the man of God. That is rubbish. It's a false prophet. Any prophet that charges is a false prophet. I'm not scared. I'm old enough at this stage now that I don't mess around with these things. And I've spoken to prophets in their face, I've told one or two, I said, you're a false prophet. But if you repent, I'll help you. Amen. Because it's not about money, it's about people. It's about souls, it's because we care. But you see, the easiest part of giving is money. If you don't give money, you're not going to give anything. It's easy to stop at the stop street and the guy needs you and you pull down the thing, you give him a 10 rand. That's cheap giving. Taking the guy and say, okay, I'm responsible for your development and your growth. Come, I'm going to help you. I'm going to teach you English. I'm going to teach you how to do a job. I'm going to teach you how to apply. I'm going to take responsibility. That costs more than 10 rand. If you don't give money, you're not going to give anything. Money is the easiest. If you struggle and you worked up about money, that's the easiest part. Come here with your money. Money, 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 money. I'll say the word over and over because it's your slave. That's why you don't want to mention it. Are you hearing me? Tell your neighbor, your pocket needs to get saved. He says, so let one each give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. If you're not cheerful, if you're not excited, what does cheerfulness mean? It means you're giving with an expectation. Amen. Look, you're only cheerful if you give with faith, knowing God's in control. If you give grudgingly, you don't have faith of multiplication. So then don't give because it's not a wise investment. Then rather keep your money, go buy yourself a McDonald's. You're going to get more joy out of your McDonald's than sowing it. You're going to get zero. If you sow this morning or you sow and you give your money grudgingly, you're going to get no returns. Then keep it. I'm helping you here. Keep the money. But when you sow with a expectant heart, knowing God's in control, that we're not tied to the economy of this world. Can I give amen there? And that's why if you don't have a job as a Christian, there is no excuse for you to be unemployed if you're a Christian. I will help you. But you can't sit at home the whole day and expect that you're going to get a job. The Bible says, if you work, you eat. If you don't work, you don't eat. Well, I don't have a job. You don't need a job to work. Then go work for free. Go volunteer. Go give your time. And when the God who checks you out, he's the boss in the meantime. So if you're doing nothing, he's not going to promote you. So if you're waiting for a job, you know what? You're going to die waiting. As a Christian, you will be employed. You will get a job. God will bless you. Amen. I don't care if there's 40% unemployment in this country. So he says, and God is able to make all grace abound towards you. In other words, he's able to multiply you, but the ableness depends on your faith. But your faith depends on your giving. All grace towards you, in not just in your finances, but that you having all sufficiency in all things. That means all sufficiency in all things. That you may have an abundance, what? For every good work. Not an abundance for my selfish self lifestyle. It's all about me. That's not what it's about. It's for every good work so that we can be a blessing to others. Can I get a big amen there? Amen. Then it goes on verse number 10. And it says, now may he who supplies seed to the sower. Who supplies the seed? And bread for food. Who supplies the bread? So God supplies food, a seed, and bread to eat. That which you need to survive, God supplies. That which you need to sow, God gives. What does He supply first? Seed. See, the reason you're not multiplying in your life, God has given you breath. How much are you paying for that? You pay that in good works. You pay that in gratitude. The fact that you're alive. Are you hearing me? So the fact that you're alive, that you have got life, now you take that and you multiply that, you sow the seed. You take your finances, you sow your seed. So when God gives unto you your life, He gives unto you your seed. Now what happens? As you sow your seed, God multiplies the seed that you sow. What does He supply? He supplies you with seed and food. The problem is you eat your seed. When you eat your seed, you don't multiply. Any farmer knows if you don't plant seed. Farmer, what are you doing? I'm waiting for the harvest. When did you sow? I haven't sown. Idiot. Right? Well, then you can say the same thing to many of the people sitting next to you right now. You're expecting a harvest, but you have not sown. Are you hearing me? Amen. He says, now may God supply and multiply the seed that you have sown. What does He multiply? The seed. He doesn't multiply the food. He doesn't multiply that which you've received. He multiplies only that which you sow. Yes. Who wants multiplication in their lives? Yes. Okay. He says, may He increase the fruits of your righteousness, that while you are enriched in everything with all liberality, which causes thanksgiving to God. Hallelujah. Is this helping you? Yes. Amen. So with that understanding, going into the next phase of our giving in COVID, the Lord has blessed us in everything that we are and everything that we do. We're thankful to the Lord. We've given over 200 million rands worth of food in 2 years. Give the Lord a hand of praise for that. Amen. We gave it away. Now, here's the thing. Where did we get that money from? We got it from the private sector. And here's the thing. We didn't get it because, you know, because we're cute. It was a supernatural connection that God brought along our way, and those doors opened. And we have just, by the way, Friday received another 25 million rand project. Give the Lord a hand of praise. And it's not like for people, we, you know, when it started, like we had years and years of relationships. Truly, if I tell you, it was supernatural. And even with the project we got now, it's not because we know people. It's not because we're politically connected. It's really grace. And here's the thing, and we're faithful. That 25 million goes to the people. I don't get a cent. Our staff doesn't get a cent. Nobody gets a cent. Nobody gets, because we're donors. We're not takers. We're not service providers. We take that and that goes to the people. And by the way, it's going to Limpopo. Okay. We'll be out there. We'll be out there. The whole of Limpopo will be, it's a project going right onto October. And we're going to be a blessing to the provincial. And once again, it's one of the private sector companies that have asked us to do that, and there's no political I know somebody or somebody knows somebody. It's like a miracle. Why us, Lord? Are you hearing me here today? So once again, coming to the place where we have now acquired land and all our capital projects. Different areas in Polokwane, we've put a lot of money into the infrastructure there. In Alberton, the same, and Nigel. And of course, the monies that come into those different projects goes to those different places as well. But in Centurion, I've got a few minutes left. I quickly want to put this thing on the screen, if you can quickly do that. And if we look at our next project, 3C Building Project, hallelujah, 2022, we've been in COVID, so that's why I haven't bothered you with this. Hallelujah. But in the meantime, God has been doing some good things. Take me to the next picture. And the first property we purchased, it's about 14, 15 hectares. That is that property there next to Cornwall Hill. And it's the now Marpius. If you come in that whole line, Marpius, the road, I don't have a flicker here. We own the whole road on the side there. And that is right next to Cornwall Hill. Coming around there, there's about 14 hectares of 14 hectares of land, which we bought and paid for cash about 4 years ago. Amen. Give the Lord a hand of praise for that. Amen. Then we wanted to trust the Lord. We wanted to trust the Lord for the next piece of land. And this is just next door to our place, just next door here, is the bull farm. We have signed the deal. We have made arrangements. We have put down the deposit. And that is approximately, at the moment, that's about 44 hectares going right around Cornwall Hill. Isn't that incredible? So that means now, if you go to the next slide, and if you go to the next slide, that means we now own approximately 60 hectares of land, of which about 44 is above the flood level. So it means that we can develop that 44 hectares of land. And that is that whole piece there. Now, if you go to the next slide, that little red dot is where we're sitting right now. Okay, so that is the building we're in. That's this building we're in right now. If you can see the size of the building, then you can understand the type of money we need to develop that whole piece of property. I was on the property the other day and I got all goosebumps and stuff like that, full of fear. And I was saying, what was I thinking? Hallelujah. In buying all this property. Hallelujah. So we seat about 2,000 in this facility here. And as you can see, that's where we're at. Now, if you go to the next slide, then you can go at different pictures that we have. And then the next slide, carry on. There you go, 10,000-seat auditorium. There you go, go on. There you go, next picture, hallelujah. Go on, hallelujah. Right, so coming to the most important slide here, hallelujah. And the northern piece of our land, we have paid off 18 million. We paid it, and we paid it cash. Give the Lord a hand of praise for that. And then if you go to the southern piece, you go to the southern piece of the land. Can you put back this? Okay. Can you just put it on the screen, please? Can you put it on the screen, please? Okay, there you go. Okay. So if you look at the southern piece of land, it cost us 21 million, excluding VAT. The deposit is 11 million. Of which we have put down 7 million already, and the other 4 million must be paid on transfer, which is 4 million, of which we have already about 1.5 million in, and we trust in the Lord we'll have that by then. So that will then be the deposit of 11 million. So 7 million paid already, and then by August, that's in a month and a half's time, we're paying the other 4 million approximately. When transfer goes through, we pay the other 4 million. And then the other 10 million, then we're going to pay off in the next 12 months, 300,000 per month times the 12 months, which is, I think they've got the wrong, it's actually 3,600. They've got the wrong slide here. And then on August, next year, 2023, we pay the remainder 7 million. It's actually 6.4 million rand. And I know that by then that money will come in. And by next year, August, we would have another piece of land paid off cash. Hallelujah. Can I get a big amen there? Amen. So I want us to plan in our giving. And there you have the 3C Building Fund. There's the account number, 210-171-290. We've got an account for the 3C Building Fund, or you put it into the normal account where you pay your tithes, and you can just put building. If you put building there, we'll automatically transfer it to the building fund. Okay, so that is what we are looking for. Are you excited about this?
Amen.
Amen. So I want to make sure that you have an opportunity to have multiplied property to you. If you want trusting God for property, invest in God's property. Hallelujah. And you can go to the next slide. There's the snap scan. You can just snap it if you want to. That's the account. It'll take you to the place where you can give and just go to the next slide. And that's it. And you can come back to me. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand of praise for that. Amen. Now, I know time is up, and I know I'm taking a bit long today, and I know time is up, and I'll have to do it faster in the next service. But once again, I want to encourage us and that we plan our giving. So I need people that God has supplied, because at the end of the day, when God gives the vision, He gives the finance and He gives the provision. Shanae and I have already transferred 2 million rand out of our house. The Lord has blessed us, and we, the Lord has been faithful, you know, in the properties that we have purchased, and it's to the amount of equity that we have in there has more than has grown with over 300%, and we're thankful for that. And therefore, we have out of that we are sowing into the building fund, and we have already transferred 2 million bucks, you know, from our personal account into the church. That's already been sown. So we've already paid. That 2 million is part of the 7 million that we've already given, and we will continue to give more because we have seen every time it's in the difficult stage. Unfortunately, usually when God gives us vision, it's usually in the toughest time of the country. Can I get a big amen there? But that's when we have sown the most. So we have sown, and this is like I think we've sown 1 million like 2 or 3 times, Shanae and I, and we are sowing, and we're not sowing it like. Because we're rich and we got money. It's the faithfulness of God towards us. Are you hearing me? But we plan the giving. It's not emotional giving. It's our lifestyle. It's who we are. And therefore, I want us to do that. And Polokwane and Alberton, Nigel, and where you guys are at, I want you to sow because we've got capital projects we're doing there as well. I want you to sow in the building for your campuses as well. And the money that comes in there, if you want to sow into Centurion, then sow into Centurion. You're welcome to do that if you want seed here. Because what are we going to do with this property? You know, I mentioned the 10,000 seater, but actually that's going to be a multi-purpose building where we can do sports because ultimately, this ground is so that we can have a university, and we trust in the Lord for a hospital as well, a training hospital and a university that can cater between 15 to 20,000 students. That is our heart. That is our heart. Can I get a big amen there? So I want to prophesy and let you know that the buildings that are going to be standing on this property are going to be worth between 5 to 10 billion rand. Listen to what I'm saying, the whole property. But we this is a multi-generational blessing. So don't worry, you don't have to supply the 10 billion. Amen. Amen. But over a period of time, over the next 50 years, over the next 100 years, and that's what we're looking. I'm not looking, you know, doing everything and everything in our lifetime. We do what God wants us to. And even we start with the land. So first of all, we got the land, now we can develop and we trust, and that's what we want. This will be the headquarters of 3C. This will be the headquarters of Makhlaseri. Can I get a big amen there? This will be the headquarters of SACOF, which represents 16,000 churches. This is going to be the place, and this is going to be a hub where we are going to train youngsters. The heart of 3C has always been for the youth, always. And it will stay. We raise up the next generation. That's what we're going to do. Amen. And therefore, when it comes to the university, that's what we're trusting God for. But we'll start off by getting the land, and then we'll take it from there, and we'll see what God wants us to do. Of course, ultimately, we want to put up a nice facility that seats about 10,000 people, and then take it from there. And that's half a billion rand. But the thing is, let's get 10 million in. How's that? Let's start there. Amen. And let's see if we can do that in the next year. And then we go on to the next project, what God wants us to do. Are you excited about that? Yes. Amen. So what I want us to do, plan your giving. I'm not going to take up offering. I'm not going to do that. I want you to plan the giving and say, Lord, I'm going to sow a seed on a monthly basis. And if you can sow a seed in this next month for the deposit, I want you to do that and put their building, and everything is going to go towards that. And we're going to be part of what God wants us to do. Are you excited? Yes. Say with me, do not worry. God's in control. He gives me food and seed. I will not eat my seed. I will sow my seed. If you want property, you sow into property. Are you hearing me? Are you blessed? Hallelujah. Let's stand to our feet. Amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed, and nobody looking around. Before we leave today, I want to make sure that everybody here knows that they're going to heaven. I want to make sure that everybody has had an opportunity to give their lives to Jesus. Unless a man is born again, the Bible says he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Every head bowed, every eye closed. And if you're here for the first time, we're speaking about finances. We do this like once a year or twice a year. It's not about finances, it's about your heart. Is your heart right? Do you know God? That's where it starts. Calling yourself Christian doesn't mean you're Christian. Coming to church doesn't mean you're Christian. The Bible says you must be born again. To be a child of God, you've got to be born of God. Born of the seed gives you the right to walk the earth, but born of God makes you His child. Plants the seed on the inside of your heart. It permeates, germinates, change, and transforms your life, and you'll never be the same again. You can't change yourself. You can modify your behavior to a certain degree, but you cannot change your heart. You cannot change your nature. Only God can change you. And therefore, while every head is bowed, every eye is closed, and you say this morning, Pastor, I want to give my life to Jesus. I need Jesus in my life. Maybe you're backslidden. You want to come back to the Lord today. If that's you, quickly slip up your hand so I can pray with you. 1, 2, 3. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I see those hands. You can put it down. I want to ask one more time, please. God is speaking to you. Don't resist the voice of God today. God loves you. He cares for you. I want to ask one more time. If you're backslidden and you want to come back to Jesus, hear the voice of God today. I want to ask one more time. Quickly raise your hand. 1, 2, 3. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I see those hands. Now I want to pray with you. I want to do a personal prayer with you. And I wonder if you can do one more thing for me. Don't be shy. Won't you just come out in the aisles? Just come stand here in front so I can do a prayer with you. Come on. Come on. Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise. Hallelujah. Yes. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Say these words with me. Say to me, dear Jesus, I need you in my life. Please forgive my sin. Take out this old nature. Fill me with your spirit. Everything that I am, I surrender unto you. I give to you. You change me. You transform me. You make me brand new. Thank you for your love, Lord. I receive it in Jesus' name. As from now, I can be called your child. And Lord, I pray over each and every person who raised their hands, every person who came forward, every power of the devil broken over your life, every curse removed, right now in the name of Jesus. I thank you for transformation that takes place. And just there where you are, church, just raise your hands. I pray over each and every person, Lord, those that are struggling with their faith as far as their income is concerned. I thank you, Lord, as from today, there will be no more anxiety or stress because you've got their backs, Lord. You supply the seed and you supply the food. And Lord, I pray that you'll place faith within their hearts that they can learn to sow and be generous and know that you're in control of their lives, that you'll take care of them, they do not have to worry, but Lord, also that you give them seed to sow. And I thank you, Lord, we will walk in faith, planning our giving and giving with a cheerful heart and expectation to be a blessing to others. And I pray the blessing of God over each and every one of you right now. And Lord, I pray that the grace of God as we go our different ways may rest upon each and every person. Whatever is needed for this week, you grant the resources needed, the faith needed, the mental capacity, emotional capacity, the wisdom needed, Lord, the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, God, in your heart and mind through Christ Jesus. And I pray that the joy of the Lord will be your strength until we return again in Jesus' name. And everybody shouted, amen. 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 God bless you.
This 3C Live experience was brought to you by the 3C Media Production. For more information, call us on 086-111-2345 or log on to my3c.tv. Or you could write to us at P.O. Box 10508 Centurion 0046 or email us at tv@my3c.tv. If you need prayer, SMS the word PRAY, followed by your prayer request to 33347, and our team of prayer warriors will pray for you for 30 days. If you would like to become a partner with the ministry, SMS the word PARTNER to 33347, and one of our team members will get back to you within the next few days. You can follow Pastors Bert and Sharnay Pretorius on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram to be inspired daily by morning devotions, ministry updates, and much, much more. Log on to my3c.tv for more information.